It is showtime.
The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Listen, baby. Ain't no mountain high, ain't no valley low, ain't no river wide enough, baby.
If you need me, call me, no matter where you are, no matter how far.
Wow, great Motown song. I guess I got to put myself in the teaching mode right now and get away from the grooving mode. Great song. By the way, all the music today has no connections to it. It's just all great music that I picked from my file of about 8 million MP3s. Today is Thursday. It's March 29th. It is our 57th two-hour Global Medical School Pathology Session. And today, after five sessions on GI, we're going to have another session on GI, only it's not the enteric GI. We're going to be talking about liver today for at least one or two sessions. And today is, let's see, it's 9:02 a.m. in Chicago. It's Central Daylight Time. And let's do our test before I make one or two small announcements and see if everybody is tuned in nicely. Can you all hear me, folks? Okay, good. Now, tell me what you see on your screen. That's the second part of the test question. It's not multiple choice. Yeah, okay, good. You got a nice flower. I got this off of somebody's Facebook page. I think it just looked great. I got one announcement to make today, which is a very nice announcement. I have been particularly proud of the extreme high quality of the movies that I have been making for each session. Now, last year, we have all of the movies made, and as you know, you can download it from my website, or if you want to buy it from somebody who's selling it online, you could do that too. Of course, that would be foolish. And they're pretty good quality, but the music is not really as good as what you hear, or what I hear, or what you hear real time. But I want to tell you, the new movies that I have just made now are spectacular. They're even better than what you hear and see over there, whatever country you're in. They're really, really great. And you'll, in fact, I originally had a problem because they were all very huge files, and I couldn't compress them down from 2 or 3 gigabytes to make them to preserve the extreme quality and still make them, you know, about 1/10 as much in memory. But I finally found the method to do it, thanks to Dr. Brandon here at my old medical school, Chicago Medical School. So probably this week I'll be spending the majority of compressing all those massive movies and putting them online for the new season. But remember, the actual content, the actual material of this year's course is not terribly different from last year. Not much drastically changes in pathology every year. But let me tell you, once you start downloading the new movies, which I'm going to be putting on my website soon, medicalschoolpathology.com, you're going to say, why the hell should I even go to the live sessions? These movies are so much better. I'm really proud of them. Okay, that was the only announcement. So let's talk about the matter at issue, and that will be liver. Today we'll be covering liver. It's a pretty good size chapter. I am hoping I could do the whole thing in one day, but knowing me, I probably won't be able to. It's really, really a very, very intensely graphic chapter. Now, I know I've talked to some of the real students around the world, and they often say, well, you know, when these pathologists come into our class, all they do is show stupid pictures, you know, and we're not really learning what we need to know for the step exam. Well, let me tell you, there are a lot of pictures on here. There's also a lot of diagrams and a lot of text. But I think that if you were to ask the pathologists, again, all around the world, okay, who wants to volunteer to do the chapter on liver, they probably would all raise their hand, because a liver is something that all pathologists love. We love to cut it. We love to talk about it. We love to look at it under the microscope. And we all think we're really, really world experts in liver diseases. Of course, we're not, but we just think we are. So having said that, let's just say it is one of my favorite chapters. It's very, very graphic. And I don't know, I think even though it's very graphic, I'm hoping you're not going to say, well, all this pathologist did was show us pictures. It's a lot like the ENT chapter, if you remember that a couple of weeks ago. The ENT chapter was also very, very graphic. But I got the feedback from you that it was appropriately graphic. So here we go. Let's talk about chapter 18. Let's talk about the parts of GI diseases that food doesn't come into contact with directly. Let's talk about the liver and bile ducts and gallbladder. And I don't know, if we could do it in one day, that'd be nice, but most likely we'll finish it up on the next session next week and then do a nice liver lab with it. So we could probably do liver in 2 sessions. Here we go, folks. Maybe because it's graphic, we can zip through it pretty fast. I don't know. Liver and biliary tract. That's the title page. Let's start out where we always start out, with embryology, which is a very keen insight into the topic of congenital diseases. Here's your embryo. And if you kind of remember, we have the esophagus, the stomach, the large bowel, the small bowel, and right here, at about the junction between the stomach and the small bowel, you have your duodenum, and you have the outpocketing of all the things we're going to be talking about in the next few sessions. Here's the liver. It's an outpocketing of foregut entoderm, as is the gallbladder, and as is the pancreas. And it looks like the pancreas outpockets dorsally with respect to the liver, but remember there's also a ventral butt on the pancreas as well. So does that mean that the stomach and esophagus are, and the tracheal bronchial tree are also outpocketings of foregut? Yes, they are. Now, if you want to remember something really cool, which it took me a few years to realize, is that if you remember your 3 big arteries in the abdomen, which is your celiac axis supplying everything you see here, and then your superior mesenteric artery supplying the small bowel, and then your inferior mesenteric artery supplying the terminal ileum and most of the large bowel. Just think of that in terms of foregut, midgut, and hindgut, respectively, because the foregut structures of the GI tract are supplied by the celiac axis in all of its variations. The midgut structures, which is primarily small bowel, is supplied by the superior mesenteric. And last but not least, the hindgut is supplied by the inferior mesenteric. And here we are developing more than the earlier picture here. And we can see that the liver has these various mesenteries here, which firmly lock it onto the diaphragm and create a variety of pouches and mesenteries. And it's not worth talking about that. So that's a good place to start is embryology, remembering that everything here within this circle is not only the distribution of the celiac axis, but also what we call as the GI derivations of the foregut. You've probably seen this before. Hopefully you've dissected it out. Basic liver structure, you know that the right lobe is several times larger than the left lobe. In the division between the right and left lobe anatomically, you have a falciform ligament. It kind of blends into the so-called round ligament or ligamentum teres, which, as you remember, carries the remnants of the umbilical vein. And it's usually closed off by then, but it could be patent either as a congenital error or when there's increased pressure, like portal hypertension. You have the coronary ligament, basically superior in the liver, and both the falciform and coronary are basically anchoring that liver down to the diaphragm. If you remember, there was a little triangular tip of the coronary ligament, which they call the triangular ligament, on the left. Technically there's a right one, but the right one is almost impossible to find and see. So if you found a triangular ligament in your anatomy lab, it was probably the left. And of course the gallbladder tucked away in the gallbladder fossa under the right lobe. Now, here's the thing to remember. I know I told you that there's a left lobe and a right lobe, and the right lobe is a lot bigger. But if you look at the branches of the left and the right hepatic arteries, as well as the branches of the left and right bile ducts, we have more of an even division. So if you were to draw a line pretty much between the inferior vena cava and the gallbladder fossa, that would be the true separation of the liver into right and left functionally and vascularly and biliary drainagely, because the whole medial aspect of the right lobe is supplied by the left hepatic artery. As well as the caudate and quadrate lobe are supplied by the left. And of course the entire left lobe is supplied by the left too. By the way, this is the left over here, okay? And there's your left triangular ligament. Now, the right has this nice, what they call renal fossa. I don't think the word renal fossa is actually a word out of the classical anatomy books, but that's what everybody calls it. And just remember all the things that the liver is coming in contact with, not just the diaphragm, but the kidneys, okay, the stomach, the flexures of the colon, and it's a very critically nicely situated organ with a very, very smooth capsule, and it's entirely intra-abdominal, isn't it? So that means that the capsule of the liver, which you could see and feel, is technically part of a visceral peritoneum as well. Okay, here's your duct system, and as you could see, we have a main branch on the right and the main branch on the left, but the one on the left is supplying parts of the right as well as the quadrate and caudate. And of course the one on the right is supplying only about half of the right lobe. Now there's a good distance here before that main duct, the common hepatic duct, joins with the bile duct to form the common bile duct. Okay. And this is never, ever, ever able to be seen in dissections of your cadavers because it's so intricately wrapped around and in the head of the pancreas. But the pancreas itself, the pancreatic duct, drains into the ampulla almost at the same time that the common bile duct does. You know, there's not much. There's some variations, but usually they're both coming in at the same point. Sometimes you can see an accessory pancreatic duct entering the duodenum separately. Sometimes it doesn't happen, but if you remember in the old days, that was called the duct of Santorini, where the main pancreatic duct in the old days was called the duct of Wirsung. Of course, nowadays with our political correctness, we're not allowed to give tribute to the masters of anatomy anymore. Okay, so you probably opened up your duodenum also and you wondered, well, where the hell is that common bile duct coming in? And you can see some of the plicae here in the opened up duodenum. There's usually a little papilla, and it's not an easy thing to find, but if you see a nice papilla there and you poke a dull probe into it, you could then go all the way up the common duct. Okay, so that's the duct system, what we're going to be talking about. This is the most important concept in liver disease to realize throughout the discussion on liver diseases. And, you know, you kind of remember the blood supply. You know, it has a dual blood supply. About 85% or 80% of the blood supply to the liver is portal venous blood, which drains all of the organs which feed into the portal venous system, and eventually those will branch and show up microscopically in your portal triad areas. And the reason why they call it a triad is because the single biggest thing, of course, is the portal vein. But very often you could see a hepatic artery, a small artery there as well. And then, of course, a bile duct as well. So those are your portal triads. And even though this is more of a conceptual concept rather than a bona fide histologic entity, you have to try to imagine that you have six portal triads or portal areas creating a hexagon. And in the middle of that hexagon is a central vein. And of course, the blood is draining from the portal veins and the hepatic arteries in about a 4-to-1 ratio. About 80% of the blood is portal vein, about 20% is oxygenated hepatic artery, and is going through the sinusoids towards the wide open central vein. You have to remember that that's a direction of flow, and that if you were to take that triangle between two adjacent portal veins and draw a triangle with respect to the central vein, that's called the asinus. Otherwise, your whole hexagonal architecture here is called a lobule. Now, that's a nice thing to remember in your mind if you have a two-dimensional mind, but here's something for the three-dimensional mind. And even this is not really anatomically perfect either, but as you could see, we have our triad here. The green thing is the bile ducts. The blue thing is the portal vein, the red thing is the artery, and they're generally oozing and filtering blood through the sinusoids towards the wide open central vein. Now, if you remember, we talked about veins as having endothelial linings, but this is more or less of just of an open channel here. I guess you can call it a vein because it drains venous blood, but it's not a perfectly endothelial lined enclosed structure. And that's basically how it goes. Now, I guess I should remind you that as the portal venous blood comes into the liver and then ultimately comes through these veins, through the sinusoids, through the central veins, through the hepatic veins, and then the inferior vena cava, you know, all the way ultimately to the right atrium, remember that's a direction of flow. And the reason why that's important to remember is because functionally, if you would like to think of the liver as nothing more than a filter between portal blood and caval or inferior vena cava or systemic blood, you can. Because if you want to think of this lobule as being scarred, then the blood can't get through very well, can it? So there's increased veins in these portal things. And that's the pathophysiologic anatomic explanation for portal hypertension with cirrhosis. Okay, this is also not a real slide, but it looks real. It's probably from a nice histologic textbook. And remember I told you they were hexagons, but in actuality, if you even see four, you're lucky. Sometimes you'll see five, and you'll almost never see six portal areas surrounding a central vein. to form the lobule. But you still have to think of them as hexagons either. So very often your pathology report will start out with the liver has a normal preserved hexagonal architecture. That's how most of my normal liver biopsy reports came out. And remember, the only place where you have true connective tissue, in other words, fibroblasts, are in these really small delineated triangles of the portal triad. All of the connective tissue in the sinusoids and around the central veins and between lobules is not true collagenous connective tissue. It's reticular fibers, just like you see in the bone marrow and the spleen and the lymph nodes. It's more delicate. There is no fibrosis in a normal liver, except for maybe a few scattered fibroblasts in the portal areas. Now, another thing I want to tell you is the person who drew this was really, really nice, because they lead you to believe that you can see a wide open central vein and a nice little artery. And of course, then the only epithelial circular looking structure or glandular structure is the bile duct. So if you're led to believe that every single portal area, you should see all three of those things, in the world of reality, that's not really true, because you almost always see a portal vein. Sometimes you don't see an artery too well, and sometimes you see either zero, one, or in this case, look, two bile ducts. So even though they call it a triad, in this case you get two ducts, and in some cases you have no easily visible artery. And also remember, the central veins are just wide open drainage areas to the sinuses. This is a little more accurately seen, and it's not quite so easily delineated on a real biopsy, but you know when you see a little bit of connective tissue here and here, if you look closely, you'll see a bile duct. That's probably a little bile duct right there. And there may be a little scattering of connective tissue to delineate this portal triad. And the delineation between this portal area and the regular rest of the hepatic parenchymal tissue is called the limiting plate. So that last little fibroblast that delineates a portal area is called the limiting plate. And it's called the limiting plate because it's supposed to limit the connective tissue of the portal area between these open sinusoids of the rest of the lobule. And as you might guess, whenever you have extension or disruption of that limiting plate or extension of fibrosis, that might be a process which ultimately might lead to cirrhosis as well. Okay, here we are looking at the gross specimen now. I want to show you something that you should really realize. You know, there's a joke, and I'll probably tell you the joke later on again. They say, when you're at an autopsy conference, how do you know which of the pathologists is the GI pathologist? And the answer is, he's the only one that's carrying a magnifying glass in his pocket. And the reason why he does that is because when you take a good look, even with regular eyeballs, at a surface of the liver, here's a nice normal surface here, and here's a nice normal surface here, you can really see tiny little red dots. Hold on, I'm going to ask you, do you see that little red dot there, and that little red dot there, and that bigger red dot there, and that little red dot there? Do you see it? Do you see those tiny red dots? Yeah, well, you know what those are? Those are actual central veins. Because what you're doing now is you're doing the remarkable process of looking at things with your naked old human being eyeballs and projecting them onto the microscope. So if you were to take that white circle with the red dot in the middle of it and put it under a microscope, that would be one hepatic lobule. Now, do you remember I also told you that in the liver, the central, the portal veins are surrounded by arteries and bile ducts? Well, look on the bigger level, look on the gross level too. Do you see how that big vein has a couple of smaller things around it that look like they're smaller, thicker vessels? Guess what? That's a larger portal area. So you know this is a large portal vein. Now, let me ask you the interesting question. What vein do you think this big vein is over here? You think that's a portal vein, or do you think that is a hepatic vein? Yeah, It's the extensions of the central veins called the hepatic veins. And the reason why it is because, look, you don't see any other thing around it. Now, can I tell you something else? If you see a wide open vein in the liver grossly, and you're not sure if it's a hepatic vein or a portal vein, what are you going to do? Just squeeze the liver. And if there's some green stuff that comes out of the tissue around it, you know that it's a portal vein, even if you can't see the bile duct. Otherwise, all of these little nice holes here that don't look like they have connective tissue or smaller ducts around them are hepatic veins, whereas the veins which either ooze green junk, which is bile, or have smaller, grossly recognizable arteries and veins around them are portal veins. Okay, here you go. Now we're getting into the real world of liver biopsies now. And once again, by the time you're done with this, you're going to be a real expert. So here's the question. We have a southwest and a northeast vein. Which one is the portal vein? Yes, the upper one is the portal vein. Which one is the hepatic vein? I'm sorry, which one is the central vein? Here's the central vein, and here's the portal vein. How do you know that? Well, because there's no connective tissue around here. There's no artery. There's no bile duct. But look, there's a little bit of collagen around here. There's a scattering of lymphocytes. And I don't know. I don't really see a bile duct, but maybe there is. But you see that little thing right above the vein? That looks to me like it's just a small artery. So where is the direction of blood flow? It's from the northeast to the southwest. Now, let me tell you the most critically important concept in liver pathology right now. In fact, it took me a few years to really understand this. In fact, it took me my whole life. I didn't realize it until a few years ago. If the blood is flowing from the portal vein to the central vein, and you have an anoxia problem in the body, like congestive heart failure, which part of the lobule is going to be the first to die? The area of hepatocytes around the central vein or the area of hepatocytes around the portal vein? Yeah, the central vein, because look, this is where the flow starts. This is where you have arterial flow too. And so the cells which get the last amount of blood are the central veins. Good, good, good. That's a key concept. It has some exceptions to it, but that's basically, you all understand liver disease. Now, here, next question. If you have a toxic compound, you know, like Tylenol or, you know, something that's really toxic to the body and toxic to the liver, which cells are probably going to get the brunt of it first? The central vein cells or the portal vein cells? Yeah, the portal vein cells. So toxic effects on cells are generally felt closer to the central vein, and ischemic effects, anoxic effects, lack of oxygen is felt close to the central vein. There's several exceptions to that theory. For example, chloroform poisoning usually causes like central vein necrosis, but or what they call central lobular necrosis. Now, if you see necrosis around the central vein, that's called central lobular necrosis. If you see necrosis around the portal areas, I don't know what to call that, but you could call it periportal necrosis, I guess. Here you go. Here is the world's most beautiful portal area. Note, the biggest, singlest, roundest, widest open thing is the portal vein. But what is this thing over here? Tell me the answer. And what is this thing over here? Tell me the answer. It's the only thing in the liver that looks epithelial. Now, what are these two little things over here? Yeah, so even though they call it a triad, remember, the most reliable thing that you see is the vein, and sometimes you often have two or three bile ducts, and sometimes you have zero, one, or two arteries. Now, here's another extremely important thing to remember. Do you see this little rim of connective tissue around here? before you get into the first hepatocyte. You see that little plate that limits the portal area from the hepatocytes? That's the limiting plate. And look, here's the limiting plate up here. Because all of these cells here on the top are normal hepatocytes. They're perfectly round nuclei. They usually have a nucleolus. These are classical hepatocytes. But look how they're well delineated from the connective tissue of the portal area. Now, do you think that if there was some inflammatory process or destructive process going on in this portal area and you started to have scarring or destruction beyond the limiting plate, do you think that that might be setting the ground for cirrhosis? Absolutely. That was a rhetorical question, but I'm glad you answered anyway. And look, here's the world's most beautiful central vein. There's even a few little blood cells in it. Oh, some of this little speckled stuff in the cytoplasm, maybe a little bit of bile. But these are just perfectly normal hepatocytes. Now, let me tell you something very simple. There's two kinds of cells in here, which is basically the only two kinds of cells you see in the liver, are the ones with the perfectly round nucleoli, usually with a nucleolus. And then you see these little spindly cells that look like this, and look like this, and look like this, and look like this. Most of these cells here, maybe 80-90%, are hepatocytes. And they're usually right in the center of cytoplasm. Those are your classical hepatocytes. Now, what do you think these little spindly cells are? Like over here, and over here, and over here? Yeah, they're called Kupffer cells. They are antigen-presenting cells. They're in the macrophage family. And the reason why they call them reticuloendothelial cells is because these sinusoids don't really have a true endothelium like veins, but these Kupffer cells act like endothelial cells, and that's why they're called reticuloendothelial. And they're called reticulo is because the old word for a macrophage, even older than the word histiocyte, is the word reticulocyte. Reticulum cell. So the old reticulum cell sarcomas were then called histiocytic lymphomas, and now we know that they're probably mostly B cell lymphomas. Okay, general patterns of hepatic injury. Remember the three classical patterns of disease we've said a million times: degeneration, inflammation, neoplasia. Well, the degeneration of hepatocytes is absolutely no different from what we saw on day one when we talked about cellular injury and death. We know that when a cell is injured or degenerated or dying, you have the failure of the sodium-potassium pump, and the cell can't pump out the sodium that well, and therefore it becomes ballooned. It might look like it's feathery, it might look like it's a little granular, it might look like it's bloated. Well, these are non-specific patterns of hepatocyte injury. Also, they can take on fat, they can take on hemosiderin. Let's say that there's hemorrhage going on in the liver or congestion, just like in the lung. Those blood cells break down to form hemosiderin. They could have obstruction of bile if there's some type of obstruction or swelling. So these are all non-specific changes to hepatocytes in common patterns of hepatic injury. Of course, in inflammation, we use the word hepatitis. We talk about inflammatory conditions of the liver. But generally, when we say hepatitis, we're usually implying a viral hepatitis, A, B, C, D, E. But remember, technically anything, any toxic effect, any parasite, which causes an inflammatory reaction in the liver can be called hepatitis as well. And of course, with that inflammation, you can have complete regeneration, which usually occurs, or you could have fibrosis. And if that fibrosis leads to a nodular, irregular pattern replacing the normal hexagonal architecture, then what's that called? I need an answer, because this is the most important question. Aha, you got it right. It's called cirrhosis. And of course, another type of general injury you could think of with hepatic injury is neoplasm. And as you know, 99% of the malignant neoplasms in the liver are metastatic. primaries are about 1%, but that varies. For example, in the United States, it's probably a 99% to 1 ratio, but in parts of Africa and Asia, you know, primary liver malignancies, hepatomas or hepatocellular carcinomas are a lot more common than they are here. In some parts of the world, it's one of the most common malignancies of man. Okay, see these cells here? What if I told you these were liver cells, but you'd first say, well, why do they look so swollen? And look, it looks like the nucleus might even be gone or dissolving in a lot of these things. Well, this is a term called ballooning degeneration, and don't be fooled by it, because all it is that this cell is injured in a nonspecific manner and therefore loses its membrane function. Remember, if a membrane function is impaired, the cell is injured, the cell will be swollen, there's more water in it. If that winds up being an irreversible membrane change, then it certainly will result in cell death. Otherwise, it could be reversible. And here's another thing called feathery degeneration. You might see that term used on a lot of pathology reports. And it's the same process. In feathery degeneration, you see swollen cells also. And you also see some granularity-like particles. So it's more than just a clear balloon. Actually, some of the cytoplasm is clumped, and that's called feathery degeneration. It's all the same term. You might think that feathery is maybe a little bit more severe than the ballooning. And here we go, probably one of the most common diseases of liver, the fatty liver. We went through all a bunch of biochemical reasons why the liver would take on fat with a variety of diseases, and of course you could review that, but you have to remember, like a knee-jerk reflex, the three common things that cause fatty liver. It's like, I knew a kid that was kicked out of medical school because some, you know, big-ass professor came up to him and said, what are the three classical findings of diabetes? And the kid was freaked out. He didn't remember. Polyuria, polyphagia, what's the third one? polyuria, polyphagia, and polydipsia. Well, he couldn't remember that, so he actually got kicked out. He sued the school, and he won, by the way. So by the same token, as a knee-jerk reflex, you have to remember the three common causes of fatty liver. One of them is obesity, one's alcoholism, and one's diabetes. Now, a good general principle is, if your body is fat, your liver is fat. Doesn't that make sense? Now, we went through a whole variety of reasons why alcoholic livers contain fat biochemically. We're not going to do that again. You can review the old thing on alcoholism. I think it was chapter 9. But alcoholics have a wide variety of inflammatory changes in their liver because the alcohol is a toxic effect and it winds up replacing normal hepatocytes with fat. Diabetes is also a big, big, big thing. So these are the three things. Remember them. Get them tattooed. They're very important. Now, if you're looking at a liver microscopically, I think you already know that when you see these little clear vacuoles, the reason why they're clear is they had fat in them, and when you do the xylene process in histology, the fat washes out. So you could call this steatosis, because steato is the root word for fat. You could call it fatty liver. You could call it fatty change. You could call it fatty metamorphosis. But why don't you just keep it simple and just call it a fatty liver. Now, do you see how most of these vacuoles here are actually smaller than the cells? There's a couple that might be larger, but most of these vacuoles, you know, the 30 or 50 vacuoles in here, are within the cytoplasm of a cell. That's called microvesicular steatosis. Now, if most of the fat was bigger than a cell, what do you think the name for that would be? It would be macrovesicular steatosis. I don't know why they divide them into these two categories, because they're basically the same thing, and macro just means bigger fat globules, you know, bigger than the size of the cells. So it's basically a process of, oh, what's the word? Severity. What do you think is more severe? Micro or macrovesicular steatosis? Thank you, macro. And whoever the people were that said polydipsia, thank you very much. I just had a minor senior moment there. Okay, now let me ask you this. There's a variety of pigments that you can also see in the liver. First of all, You can see bile sometimes. If you do a good bile stain, you can see little clumps of bile, not only in the canaliculi, but bile here and bile there, just doing its normal thing. That's an intrinsic pigment. Okay. You can also see hemosiderin, because the liver is a great place for having red cells hang around. And if they hang around too long, like in heart failure, those red cells can break down and the iron can eventually become hemosiderin, and the hemosiderin is chewed up by the macrophages. And the third golden intrinsic pigment is called melanin. And of course, you don't normally see melanin in the liver, do you? So when we talked about our classic pigments for, you know, intrinsic as well as extrinsic, we said the extrinsic pigments are usually very, very black, like tattoo pigment or anthracosis. But the intrinsic pigments all look the same. They're kind of a golden brown refractile pigment. And sometimes you look into the liver and you see this golden brown refractile pigment. And you don't know, is this melanin or is this bile? So let me ask you this. If you did a Prussian blue stain and that golden brown refractile pigment became intensely blue, then what is it? Is it bile or is it iron? Okay, now I guess you could get melanin in the liver if there were some metastatic melanomas going to the liver, but normally whenever you see golden pigment in the liver, it's either hemosiderin. There's also a couple of other things it could be, like lipofuscin, but generally a pigment in the liver is either hemosiderin or bile, and they both look the same until you do the special stains. Once again, here's our little lobule again. Very, very important. Now let's get into some other normal or pathologic changes. For example, the concept of apoptosis. We've driven this into the ground. We all know that apoptosis can occur in pathologic injury. It can also occur as a normal pre-programmed way for the liver cell to die. So when you're looking at a liver cell, this does not look like a normal liver. It looks like it's a little more congested and probably has a couple more inflammatory cells than it should. But you see a couple of red things here. Like here's a red thing and here's a red thing. It doesn't really look like blood or a blood vessel. That's an apoptotic hepatocyte. Okay? And look at, as you remember, when cells die, either through apoptosis or from injury, they lose their nucleus. The nucleus dissolves, karyorrhexis, karyolysis, and the cytoplasm becomes more redder. That's normal apoptosis. In this case, it may be abnormal apoptosis because I see a few inflammatory cells around here. And we'll get to this later, but when you see a more than an average number of apoptotic liver cells, and you know the patient has hepatitis, then what would you call those red apoptotic hepatocytes? They're called Councilman bodies. And in the old days, we looked very hard for Councilman bodies because we were told they're very, very highly linked to viral type B hepatitis. Now we know you could see them in a wide variety of areas and even in normal apoptosis. So, inflammation of the liver in general occurs in the portal tracts, especially in the early phase, because that's where they normally have, you know, a few lymphocytes, a few macrophages, a few fibroblasts. That's the only place that can occur early, because that's the only place where there are normally inflammatory cells. If it was more severe, like if this was a very, very mild hepatitis, a viral hepatitis or some other type of hepatitis, you'd probably see mainly a triaditis. That's another word that you might see on the pathology report. If it is more severe, patient is clinically worse, the enzymes are higher, it could extend from that limited triad area into the sinusoids and be a more severe form. So mild hepatitis, portal triads, more severe hepatitis into the sinusoids. What do you think this is? Well, it's a liver, and you can see there's probably some congestion in these sinusoids. But you would have to make a little judgment that maybe there's a few extra lymphocytes here in this portal area. And would you want to call this a mild triaditis? Well, that's what I would call it, a mild triaditis. But if you were really kind of a hard ass and you want to say, well, I want to see more lymphocytes than that, then I wouldn't blame you. Now, in this case, however, is undebatable, is that not only are there a whopping number of lymphocytes in this portal area, but look, it's extending into the hepatocytes themselves. Okay, so not only is this more of a severe triaditis, but it looks like it might even be breaching the limiting plate and going into the sinusoids. Now, if all of this stuff is ultimately followed by fibrosis, like you see these little spindly cells here, I bet you that these are probably fibroblasts. Okay, there can't be smooth muscle cells. If it got to the point where it actually caused a nodularity and you no longer saw the integrity of the normal hexagonal architecture, then what would you diagnose that liver as being? Absolutely, cirrhosis. Okay, we're making some good time here. The liver is classically the most regenerative of all organs. Okay, now, the only thing I could tell you for that is a very personal anecdote. I practiced nuclear medicine for many years as well, and we used to do a million liver scans. And sometimes we would do a follow-up on patients that have had a partial hepatectomy. You know, maybe they had, an entire left lobe removed or half of the right lobe, you know, because of a malignant tumor, usually primary tumors. But, you know, they were even doing partial hepatectomies for solitary metastasis. I don't know how smart that is anymore. It might still be done. But very often, you know the patient has had half of his liver removed, but you do a follow-up liver scan like 6 months or a year or 2 years later, and it looks like the liver grew back. Okay, so remember that little story. The liver has massive powers of regeneration, more so than any other organ. You'll never see that with the heart. You'll never see that much with the kidney. You'll never see it with the pancreas. You'll never see it with the spleen. Now, let's talk about fibrosis. You know that inflammatory, necrotic, normal processes can happen in the liver to a wide variety of causes, and we also know that fibrosis is often the end stage of this inflammatory or necrotic or destructive process. We also know that you could have complete resolution as well. But let's say that you have fibrosis. Let's say that little bit of fibrous tissue, which is in the area of the triad, is now extended beyond the triad. In fact, not only has it extended beyond the triad, but it has extended to adjacent portal areas. Well, remember one thing, fibrosis in itself is not cirrhosis. But when the fibrosis extends to adjacent portal areas, and now the so-called hexagonal lobules are now irregular nodules, then what is that the definition of? I know I've said it, but I gotta say it again, because, you know, when I was in medical school, there was only two times that our professor made us stand up and repeat something after him. And I'm sorry, but I'm gonna have to do it to you too. And you're probably gonna think this is stupid, but it's so important. This is the most important part of the lecture here, so I want everybody to stand up, okay? Stand up. Hey, you too, you know? And if you're not typing, I know it's because you no longer have any hands reach to your computer. But I am right now going to tell you the only two things that you have to see to diagnose cirrhosis. And it doesn't matter what kind of cirrhosis. It doesn't matter what adjective you put in front of the cirrhosis. You need only two things to diagnose cirrhosis. So repeat after me. Cirrhosis is two things. Number one, cirrhosis is bridging fibrosis between the portal areas. And number two, cirrhosis is the creation of nodules replacing the normal hexagonal lobules because of the fibrosis. Okay, you can all sit down. And I'm going to ask you just one last question here. I want everybody to answer. Did you all stand up and take the oath? Good. I'm seeing everybody said yes. That's very, very important. Okay, now, you know, cirrhosis is a term that is often used wrong, and I just want to tell you, I went to this little website here called OneLook, and if you've been to OneLook, and you put in the word cirrhosis and you put a little asterisk in front of it, it'll tell you all of the words that are commonly used before the word cirrhosis. And in this case, I found 50 words that are commonly used before cirrhosis. And most of them are adjectives and some of them are types of cirrhosis. But I want to tell you, all cirrhosis is the same. It's nodules and it's fibrosis. Probably the most common word used before cirrhosis is liver, but of course all cirrhosis is from the liver, so that's redundant. Sometimes the word alcoholic cirrhosis is used, implying that the alcoholic toxicity chronically was the cause of the cirrhosis. Sometimes the word biliary cirrhosis is used. It's not just an adjective, it's a classification, it's a type of cirrhosis in which the cirrhosis starts out from inflammation around the bile ducts and the triads. If it's autoimmune, it's called primary. If it's secondary to some rising infection from the gut bacteria, it's called secondary. Sometimes the word Lennox cirrhosis is used, and that's also called alcoholic cirrhosis. And Lennox is the guy who described it. It's also called nutritional cirrhosis. So alcoholic cirrhosis, Lennox cirrhosis, nutritional cirrhosis, they're all the same. Now, can I ask you another question? Who do you think it was? Who do you think the guy was that invented that little stethoscope that you go swinging around your neck when you're walking up and down the hospital wards all the time? Who do you think was the guy that invented your stethoscope? It was Lennox. Look it up. Google it. So another adjective used before cirrhosis is advanced. But I object to the word advanced also because all cirrhosis is advanced. All cirrhosis is irreversible. So advanced cirrhosis is a very much a redundant and unnecessary term, and it implies that some cirrhosis may not be advanced. That's why I hate it. All cirrhosis is advanced. Sometimes the word post-necrotic is used as an adjective or a classification, implying that the cirrhosis has followed a necrotic process in the liver, and that's a nice adjective. And sometimes the word micronodular and macronodular is used. And it doesn't make any difference, but I want to tell you something. Micronodular cirrhosis is where the nodules are so small that they're approximately the same size as a normal hepatic lobule. You very often can't see them with your eyeballs, and you very often can't feel them either. Now, macronodular is something that you could see and feel. So if I had to put a blindfold on you and gave you a macronodular cirrhosis, half of you would probably feel tiny nodules and half of you would be honest and not feel anything. But if I put blindfolds on you and showed you a macronodular cirrhosis, you just rub your finger over either the capsule or a cut surface and you know those are nodules. So these are all the types of cirrhosis. Now, here's another thing I want to tell you, and you know, you're gonna get a lot of baloney from people, but I want to tell you the truth here. All cirrhosis is irreversible. If you have true documented cirrhosis, you'll never get a normal liver back again. You're gonna die. The diagnosis of cirrhosis is approximately as severe as the diagnosis of metastatic carcinoma. Now, can people with cirrhosis go on for many, many years and have it relatively under control? Of course they can, just like people with metastatic cancer can go on for many, many years and have it under control. But all cirrhosis is irreversible. Okay, now the longer that cirrhosis is there, the more the nodules are being formed. And whenever you have a hyperplastic condition in which nodules are constantly turning over, you now have what they call the promoter for carcinoma. Remember, the initiator was the carcinogen and the promoter was the hyperplastic agent? Well, all hepatomas or hepatocellular carcinomas arise from cirrhosis. I've never seen a hepatoma that was not present in a non-cirrhotic liver. All hepatomas come from cirrhosis. And of course, hepatoma is exactly the same term as hepatocellular carcinoma. Now, we're back in the anatomy lab, and I put the blindfold on you, and I take out the guy's liver, and I put your gloves on you. And of course, in the old days, we may not have even used gloves until the bloodborne pathogen police came after us. And now you're rubbing the surface of the liver. If the entire liver surface, the capsule, the mesothelial, the visceral peritoneum is as smooth as ever, that person probably doesn't have cirrhosis and he probably doesn't have metastatic disease. Yeah, you could probably have something on the inside that's a metastatic tumor, but remember, cirrhosis is a diffuse process. You can't have cirrhosis in the left lobe and it's not in the right lobe. If you have cirrhosis, you have it in every millimeter of your liver, okay? Now let's say that we kept the blindfold on you and we asked you to feel this liver. And you say, well, there's a lot of little nodules and they're all over. So my question to you would be, well, if they're little nodules and they're all over, is this metastatic disease or is this cirrhosis? What's your answer? Yeah, because if it was metastatic disease, there might be a few nodules, but there would be areas that are smooth as well. Or some of the nodules might be really big and some of them might be really small, and then there'll be a lot of areas where there wasn't. Now keep your blindfolds on and feel this liver now. And I want you to give me the diagnosis before you even cut the liver or look at the liver. Any idiot can give you a diagnosis with the blindfold on of what's going on in this liver. This is Mets.
Correct.
Furthermore, do you think this is metastatic disease to the liver, or do you think this is a hepatoma? Let's say it was a hepatoma. Would you be seeing little nodules all over the place, or do you think you might primarily see one big nodule and maybe a little bit of bumpiness around it? But in hepatoma, basically you just have one area and maybe a couple of satellite areas. It's not diffuse like you see here. Okay, here's the cut surface of that liver. And here's the nodular pattern, as you could see and you could feel. And by the way, is this micronodular or macronodular here on the right? If you could see the nodules, it's macro. Now, what is this on the left? That's a normal liver. Now, let me ask you the key question of the day. And I hope I'm being fair. Oh, hold on. Let's see if I can. Oh, I don't think I could do this. But do you see those tiny little red dots in a pinker background? There's about five or six of them here. What are those? Those are central veins. And by the way, you see that big vein there? Is that a portal vein or is that a hepatic vein? Good. You see that vein over there? Is that a portal vein or is that a hepatic vein? It looks like there's a little white thing above it. It might even be green. If you weren't sure whether that was a portal vein or a hepatic vein, what would you do? You squeeze it and see if there's some green gunk that oozes out of it. If green gunk oozes out of a hole, you know it's a portal vein. Okay. We've said it before. We're going to say it again. There's normally no connective tissue in the liver, maybe just a few little fibroblasts and inflammatory cells, macrophages in the portal area, but this is limited from the rest of the lobule. In fact, even adjacent lobules are not separated by connective tissue. Here's a needle biopsy, and you know that because it's straight. Here's one that's thicker, but it's also straight. So let me ask you this. You have a needle biopsy of a liver and you stain it and it looks like this. The question is, do you really have to go to high power in order to diagnose cirrhosis? Absolutely not. Next question. Why do we do trichrome stains on almost every liver biopsy? The reason why we do it is because sometimes nodules of cirrhosis might be hard to differentiate between normal hepatic lobules. But if you see true green collagen totally surrounding hepatic tissue, then you know that this is cirrhosis. Now, can I ask you another interesting question? Do you see any central veins in the middle of these nodules? Think about it. If you have cirrhosis and now this normal filter that goes between portal blood and hepatic blood, or what they call caval blood or systemic venous blood, is no longer present, do you think that those central veins will either be absent or hardly ever seen? Yeah. So those of you that said you see central veins in the middle of nodules of cirrhosis, that's absolutely wrong. There's one person named John who always gets everything right, and he knows the right answer. You don't normally see central veins in the nodules of cirrhosis. Here's another trichrome stain, and look how thick this fibrous tissue is. And on this one, you probably wouldn't even need a trichrome stain because look how nicely these nodules are. But note, do you really see any central veins in the middle of those nodules? That's my question. No. Okay, good. Here's the last cirrhosis trichrome, and I think I've overkilled this now. Now, what time is it? It's 10 o'clock, so you know what? We're doing really good here. We're about halfway done with liver. We're going to take our break now, but remember, we've been talking a lot about anatomic changes and stuff. We're going to get more into clinical features and enzymology and stuff like that, and we're going to hepatitis and finish this off in the second hour, possibly. But I want to ask you a question now because of my normal insecurity. Do you think that this first hour of heavy, heavy, heavy graphic PowerPoints was unnecessary? Well, I see one yes, and I see about mostly no's. I see two yeses. I see mostly necessaries. Okay, well, good. This is the type of presentation I like to give, where I show a lot of visual things, but I can also talk about them. Now, if you were to just download those PowerPoints and not have me talk over them, you probably wouldn't know what the hell this was all about. But that's why we have my talking mouth, is to explain the PowerPoints. So let's go from my talking mouth to some singing mouths, and we'll see you in 10 minutes. And we're going to start out with a great, great Aerosmith thing during our break.
Don't wanna miss a thing, 'cause even when I dream again,
Break, and maybe we could finish off Liver. You just never know. I did get one sort of wicked thought during the break. Sometimes I get wicked thoughts. And let me just tell you something. I've been on like a real ego trip these days. I've been getting a lot of things sent to me from different countries. Iceland was the most spectacular start, and then we had stuff from Romania. I put them on my Facebook. I get a few pictures from students, their classes, their classmates, their medical schools, and it thrills me beyond belief. That is what I do this for. I do not do it for money. I do it for gratitude. That's my price. So the wicked thought that I got was, if you have an easily available digital class picture, or a picture of a group of you students, please send it to me. I'll consider that my payment. In fact, I'll go one step further. If I get a good class picture from you and a couple of words with it, I'll give you an A for the course. Is that a deal? I mean, I can be bribed, okay? I do sell grades. So if you want to send me a class pic, I would be eternally grateful. You get an A for the course, and you could then tear my tuition bill in half. Is that a deal? Let's continue with cirrhosis now. We've been talking about cirrhosis very, very much anatomically, and now we're going to be relating all this stuff to the clinical features, or most of the common clinical features. Remember, cirrhosis is what we talked about. Cirrhosis is portal fibrosis and nodules. That's all it is. Liver failure is the sequence of events clinically that you see in a person that has end-stage liver anatomically, which we called cirrhosis. So here's a real person here, and here's your nodular liver. As you might guess, the more fibrotic it is, the smaller it might be, because scars shrink, don't they? In the early stages, where there might be a lot of inflammation and swelling, the liver can actually be enlarged. You know, the normal liver is about 1,500 grams. Actually, we say 14 to 18 are the two standard deviation limits, but let's say 15 is a round number. And the reason why it's a really round number is because the spleen is normally 150 grams, and so is each kidney. So you could say that the liver is 10 times bigger than the spleen, and the kidneys are the same size as the spleen. In cirrhosis, you have fibrosis, and that fibrosis means that your now filter between your portal venous system, remember the splenic vein, the superior mesenteric vein, the inferior mesenteric vein, this portal blood cannot drain too easily, you know, into those portal veins, into the sinusoids, into the central veins, into hepatic veins, into the inferior vena cava, into the right atrium, because the liver is scarred down. So that's a very, very easy anatomic concept of portal hypertension. And of course, if your splenic vein is increased in pressure, that spleen is going to become edematous. If the superior and inferior mesenteric veins, also part of the three veins that make up the portal vein, has increased pressure, you can have edema not only in all the organs that it drains, you know, the pancreas, the small bowel, the large bowel, but branches of the portal vein which are normally closed off, like for example the umbilical vein, it may be totally sealed shut, or it may just be partially patent. It may be theoretically patent in adult life, but if you have a lot of pressure in the portal vein, that's going to open it up, and you're going to see this caput medusae, which is the branching of the umbilical veins. Remember, these are the things that lead up into the round ligament, into the falciform, into the round ligament of the liver. And technically, your connections now in the esophagus and stomach, where you have anastomoses between portal veins and caval veins, those will show increased pressure. And also hemorrhoids. Hemorrhoids are not just from straining at the stool too much and having increased abdominal pressure. It's also, remember, some of your hemorrhoidal veins have connections with the portal system too. Some of them don't, but these are the three areas where you get, besides general portal hypertension, you get varicosities, and that's around the abdomen, that's in the esophagus and stomach, and it's also with hemorrhoids. Testicular atrophy, hepatic encephalopathy, malnutrition, spider angiomas. These are things that we have to understand as well. The reason why you get testicular atrophy is that when you have cirrhosis, your balance of androgens and estrogens becomes off. So you have an overabundant of estrogens if you're a male and you have cirrhosis. And estrogens causes testicles to atrophy. Estrogens also are related to the development of dilatations of blood vessels in the skin, which are called spider angiomas. So talk about spiders in cirrhosis patients as well. We all know what the caput medusa is due to. The ascites is simply from the fact that if the liver is the major producer of albumin and it's now dead or dying, and you don't have enough albumin, which is the major oncotic protein in your veins, you are no longer having good entrance of fluid into those veins. So ascites, as well as edema elsewhere, is a big feature as well. Hepatic encephalopathy is regarded as an end-stage complication of cirrhosis and liver failure, because the very, very last thing your liver loses in cirrhosis, its ability to make urea, and therefore you have free nitrogen or ammonia type compounds floating around. It causes a direct toxic effect on the brain. Here's an ascites. You'll probably see a lot of these in the hospital. You're thinking, well, why can't that person just be fat, you know? Well, the one reason is that you could see that this is an extreme outie on the umbilical area, but also you know that you could detect fluid in this abdomen just by putting your hand right in the middle there of the abdomen and tapping one end of it and feeling the fluid wave go to the other side. So you know that's not fat. The fat wouldn't do it. You know it's not air. Air wouldn't do it. That's classical for ascites. Okay, here's a spider angioma, and they're basically irregular type dilatations of dermal blood vessels, and they look like they have little spider branches. That's often linked to increase of estrogens as well. Portal hypertension, we all know why that happens, because there's fibrosis and that filter now between portal blood and cable blood is blocked, and therefore you have portal hypertensions. We know we have the ascites because of the lack of oncotic pressure due to the absence of enough albumin. It's different from the fluid that you get with heart failure and renal failure. In heart failure, it's basically a backlog effect, or it's a situation in which you have the activation of the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone axis, therefore retention of sodium. Why is the spleen enlarged? Well, the spleen is enlarged because of portal hypertension. Why is the liver enlarged? Well, the liver is enlarged at first because of swelling and portal hypertension, but as the liver progresses, it gets smaller and smaller because scars contract. You remember that. Why are the patients jaundiced? Well, the patients are often jaundiced because the swelling of the liver interferes with the proper drainage of the bile. So you know it's probably going to be primarily a conjugated bile that builds up, bilirubin, rather than unconjugated. Why is the patient frequently anemic? Well, if you have splenomegaly, you now have hypersplenism. So the anemia of the classical anemia of cirrhosis is a hemolytic anemia because you have an overactive, enlarged, congested spleen. We all know the estrogenic effects of the spiders and of the testicular atrophy. One of the things that the old pathologist would do is to take out a testicle on a cirrhosis patient, and they would cut it in half, a male cirrhosis patient obviously, and then they would take their forceps and try to tweak out the individual seminiferous tubules. And you know, if you do that in a normal patient, you see these little stringy seminiferous tubules. But if this patient has cirrhosis and those testicles are atrophic and they're now fibrotic, you can't tweak out the little tubules. It's an old pathologist trick. I did it a few times myself. It's really a cool thing you could do during an autopsy. You know that factors 2, 7, 9, and 10 are made by the liver. So if you have cirrhosis, you have deficiencies of these, and therefore a lot of reason for bleeding as well. And of course, encephalopathy is usually the terminal event before death and cirrhosis, biochemically speaking. A lot has been said about hepatic enzymes, and even to GI doctors and internists, this is a very, very confusing term. And they think you got to look at enzymes like it's you need a degree in rocket scientist to figure it out. But hepatic enzymes are very, very, very easy if you just remember two things. There's two kinds of enzymes. They're the enzymes that are inside of the hepatocytes, like AST and ALT, and they are also called in the old days SGOT and SGPT. They're also called transaminases generically. And these enzymes live inside the hepatocyte. So if that hepatocyte is damaged, these enzymes escape and they're going to be elevated. So transaminitis is primarily the result of hepatocyte damage. LDH was also in that group as well, but LGH is the least specific of all of these. LDH is practically in every cell. And SGOT and PT are in a whole bunch of other places too. Now, the second type of enzyme is not in the cell, but it's membrane associated. And classically, this is your alkaline phosphatase type of enzyme. A more specific one can be called GTP for gamma glutamyl transpeptidase, and 5'N. These are all membrane-bound enzymes. And whereas the transaminases are primarily reflections of hepatocyte damage, the membrane-bound enzymes are primarily indicative of bile stasis and or obstruction. Now, that sounds easy enough, doesn't it? But you have to remember, it's almost impossible to have hepatocyte damage without some type of edema or theoretical obstruction. And it's almost impossible to imagine some type of hepatocyte stasis or bile stasis obstruction where there's no hepatocyte damage either. So these two go hand in hand. And very often when you have a significant elevation of one, you have some elevation of the other. It's almost never one or the other. But often, when you look at the enzymes, if the transaminases are primarily elevated more than the membrane ones, you can think it's probably more of an acute damage process like hepatitis. Whereas if you see that these may be elevated, but the ALK-Phos et al. Are even more elevated, then you're probably thinking some type of obstruction. Maybe even a destruction, might even be swelling of the hepatocyte, or it could be a carcinoma of the head of the pancreas. Or it could be an obstruction due to inflammation of the bile ducts. It could be obstruction due to certain drugs as well, what they call cholestasis. You know, the male and female hormones are famous for cholestasis. So, here we go. The transaminases, in other words, what you now call AST, ALT, they're indicative of primarily hepatocyte damage. And your so-called ALK-Phos family of enzymes like GGTP and 5'N, these are more of an obstructive thing. So damage versus obstruction, transaminases versus membrane enzymes. Here's jaundice. Prime place to see jaundice in your patients, if you don't really see it too well elsewhere, is in the sclera and conjunctiva of the eye, is also in the soul. And remember, you may not see jaundice, obviously, in the black patient as you was in the white. So really, the eyes and the palms are really the best place to look. You have to remember that jaundice could be primarily because of two reasons. It could be because of an increase in unconjugated bilirubin, or it could be because of an increase in conjugated bilirubin after it goes to the liver. So if you have a hemolytic process going on, remember the hemolytic anemias or anything in which there's increased destruction of red cells, and you have an increase then in bilirubin, which is the breakdown product ultimately of heme and biliverdin. It goes through a whole big chemical step. But increase in bilirubin that hasn't been conjugated yet, and remember it's called unconjugated, and that's measured by the indirect bilirubin test. Remember, indirect means unconjugated. your normal bilirubin is only like about 1 milligram per DL, and if it's a little bit over that, that's okay. But if it's like 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, probably by the time it gets to be 5 or 6 or 7, you're starting to see yellow eyes and pounds. Now, if that bilirubin has a problem in being conjugated or in being obstructed after it's conjugated, you would see an increase in conjugated bilirubin. Of course, if it's not being conjugated because of an enzyme or cellular problem, it's going to be mostly unconjugated and indirect, isn't it? Now, otherwise, once it's conjugated, it should be secreted in the bile, go into the bile duct, come out in the feces and whatnot. But if the bile ducts are obstruct, or the intrahepatic bile ducts are obstruct, or the carcinoma of the head of the pancreas, or perhaps even just some swelling of the liver due to a hepatitis, you're going to see jaundice. So there you go. There's the general principle. Hemolytic is unconjugated. Obstructive is conjugated. Let's say that you had a excessive production of bilirubin due to a really big hemolytic anemia. Well, that would cause an increase in unconjugated bilirubin, wouldn't it? Because the liver can't keep up with it. Or let's say that there's some problem in the liver, some enzyme problem, other problem, which results in that liver not even being able to take up the unconjugated bilirubin. Well, then that would be also an increase in unconjugated bilirubin. Or let's say you had some enzyme problem associated with the conjugation of bilirubin, you know, inside the hepatocyte. Then it would also be an increase in unconjugated bilirubin, wouldn't it? Let's say that you conjugated the bilirubin, but now you can't transport it. The liver is swollen, the ducts are obstructed, there's a cancer of the head of the pancreas, then you would have increase in conjugated bilirubin, or a defect in transportation. And if you wanted to also say that that's generally related to sluggishness of bile flow, or something we call cholestasis, you can do that as well. Got to say a special word about the kids. There's a couple of diseases you should know about quickly. There's a very common disease. It's about 5 or 10% of newborns. It's called Gilbey syndrome. I know it looks like it's Gilbert's, and I always call it Gilbert's, but some of my pure holy friends tell me you should call it Gilbey. Well, if you have a impaired amount or low amount of glucuronyl transferase involved in the conjugation of that, then that's one reason, common reason for a neonatal genetic jaundice. In Dubin-Johnson syndrome, not quite as common as Gilbey, but it's also, you know, you might see a case or two of that in your life. There's a problem with the transportation of the bile after it's conjugated, of the bilirubin after it's conjugated. That's another genetic neonatal jaundice. But practically speaking, most of the jaundice that you see in the newborn nurseries and neonatals, they are not caused by these relatively uncommon genetic neonatal diseases. They're caused by everything. Well, let me tell you, in a newborn baby, if that baby's jaundice, the differential diagnosis is basically everything. Whenever a baby has an infection, they're jaundiced. It seems like if you were to ask somebody to give me the differential diagnosis of neonatal jaundice, you'd say everything. So if you've been to a newborn nursery, you know that they all have these little fluorescent light fixtures, because the fluorescent lights are supposed to help the jaundice. And also, what was I going to say? If you do rotate through pediatrics, the one thing you'll probably be doing every day is drawing blood for bilirubin levels every day on babies that are sick due to any cause. So I'm not going to give you a big long list. I just want to tell you, just about every kid with an infectious or serious problem, pulmonary, you know, renal, hepatic, is going to be jaundiced. Okay, we opened the word for cholestasis, so let's define it. Cholestasis is stasis of bile flow. It's flow that's obstructed, it's flow that's sluggish, it's flow that's suppressed. Now, if you have a primarily cholestatic situation in the liver, that's going to show up primarily as higher elevations of your alkaline phos or gamma GTP or 5'N, but most likely it's not just obstructed for no reason. There may be some hepatocyte damage as well, so you'll almost always see some elevation of the transaminases as well. The thing to remember with cholestasis is that a lot of drugs, especially steroids, a lot of common antibiotics cause cholestasis. And the general rule is, if you put a patient on any drug and you look at the package insert to that drug and it says make sure that you do enzyme levels before you put this patient on the drug, chances are that's a drug that has been indicted as possibly causing either liver damage or cholestasis. And as you know, probably a lot of the drugs that you use have that on the package insert. So what are the primarily cholestatic drugs now? Well, there's a big long laundry list down here, and some of them I never heard of, and some of them I can't even pronounce. But if you want to put them into general categories, just think of androgens, estrogens, progesterones, oral contraceptives. So steroid drugs are the big family of things causing cholestasis, but also a lot of the antibiotics as well. This is what cholestasis looks like under the microscope, and as you can see, we have some nice hepatocytes here. But look, do some of these normally eosinophilic hepatocytes look a little brownish? Well, that's because there's a bile accumulating within those hepatocytes, and that's because it's not being transported properly. Here's a portal triad. There's a nice vein. I don't know. I don't really see a good bile duct here, and I don't even see a good artery. But you can see that there's increased bile. And if you think this is hemosiderin rather than bile, then do a hemosiderin stain. It's not going to turn green. The trichrome is not going to turn this green. And there are bile stains as well. Also, remember, the hemosiderin that you usually see in liver is inside of macrophages. The brown pigment that you see here, you can tell are clearly within hepatocytes. Now, I know in extreme hemosiderosis, hemochromatosis, you can get iron inside of hepatocytes as well. Here's a nice picture if you have a nice microscope. And you see like a couple of hepatocytes here. Here's three of them. And look at, you see kind of like a little bit of bile pigment between the cells. And that could be possibly in a very early stage of cholestasis, because it's actually the little canaliculi. Remember, the tiny little structures that run between the hepatocytes are being plugged or made wider because of the inability for that bile to flow through. Sometimes you hear the word bile plugs or bile lakes. I guess they're the same thing. Maybe lakes are bigger than plugs. But in this case, you could see some bile inside of cells, but you can also see areas where the bile is outside of the cells. This is getting bigger now. So if you think that bile plugs and bile lakes are a little bit more severe than the little bit of bile here you see between the cells, then you're absolutely right. It's just a matter of severity. It's not a different process. You ready for viral hepatitis? Let's talk about it. There's five kinds, A, B, C, D, E. They've evolved over the generations. They really didn't have C. When I was a resident, they called it non-A, non-B. Now they got viruses for all these different types. Who knows? Maybe by the time this lecture is over, there'll be an F. But just a few words about the things that are not B or C, okay? Hepatitis A, very mild, very common throughout the world, very non-dangerous, usually subclinical. And of course, D and E are also relatively rare and tropical. So really what we want to focus our attention on is the viruses B and C. And remember, all these viruses are different viruses. They come from different families, they're different types, but they called them A, B, C, D, E in the order in which they were discovered. So worldwide, B is still the primary viral hepatitis of concern, in terms of severe disease, in terms of cirrhosis, in terms of hepatoma. And C, especially in the United States, is a very, very big concern as well. So that's what we'll devote our attention to. Now, any one of these hepatitises can be subclinical. You don't even know you have them. Or, theoretically, they can also be fulminant, or they could cause such violent damage within the liver that the liver totally collapses, the lobules collapse, they fail, and you die. And of course, hepatitis B is the big one for causing fulminants. I wouldn't be surprised if all these others may have had some rare case reports as well. Any of the hepatitis, the usual process is full recovery within a few weeks, but it can progress over many years. If it progresses over many years, it could lead to cirrhosis. Okay, it's not uncommon. It is not uncommon for a chronic viral hepatitis, B or C, to progress for many years and lead to cirrhosis. Also, once you have that cirrhosis, you now have an increased risk of hepatoma or hepatocellular carcinoma. And remember, if you have cirrhosis or you have hepatoma, you know, you could very easily die. Now, you can also die sometimes in the acute stages of hepatitis as well. And that's much more so with hepatitis B than hepatitis C. So, let's look at hepatitis clinically. You all know that patients are generally jaundiced if they're clinical expressive. Most cases of hepatitis are subclinical. There are no symptoms, there's no viral symptoms, there's no discoloration of the stool or the urine, but when they are clinically involved, they're jaundiced. Okay, they're jaundiced because the inflammation in the liver interferes with the normal passage of bile and conjugation, you know, to where it's supposed to go. A general principle, and I know this because I had it myself many years ago, the urine gets darker and the stool gets lighter. Okay, that's because the pigments that are involved, I don't want to go through all the biochemistry of it, but there's an increase in pigments in the urine and a decrease of pigment in the stool. So the urines are dark, the stools are chalky, and this usually follows a viral prodrome. In other words, a period of chills, muscle aches, you think you're coming down with the flu, you know, and then a few days later you turn yellow and your stools become light and chalky and the urine becomes dark. You may think you're just having an upper respiratory infection, or it may follow an upper respiratory type of infection. And as you might guess, all of the viral hepatitises have a multiple ways of detecting the viral antigens and the viral antibodies of various types. We talked about in the acute phase, you will see an increase in apoptotic hepatocytes, and we had called those Councilman bodies. You know, they were really, really nice to see with hepatitis B. And I would like to tell you they're diagnostic of hepatitis B, but as you know, apoptotic hepatocytes are seen not only in all the types of hepatitis in increased numbers, but there's even normal livers too, rarely. So here's what a hepatitis looks grossly, and if you say, hey, this looks like a normal liver, then you're right, because it does look like a normal liver. There's no cirrhosis. I think if you were to be honest, you'd say this is a normal liver, but if you wanted to be really smart, you could say, well, you know, this liver looks a little bit more edematous than usual. And that's usually a diagnosis of squeezing it. It's not a diagnosis of sight. Now, once again, the thing I wanted to show you about this is, do you see that beautiful little red dot right there? And do you see that beautiful little red dot right there? And that one and that one? Well, actually, your eyes are now a microscope, because these are the central veins. And look, can I ask you something else? If you just look at the dispersion of these red dots and you had a vivid imagination, would you say they generally are pretty well spaced, maybe even sort of hexagonal, okay, if you have a good imagination? So you know this is not cirrhosis. However, you should also know that any hepatitis can lead into a cirrhosis if you don't recover from it, okay? Here is a hepatitis microscopically. You could see, generally speaking, Even though most hepatitises are subclinical, I don't want to make you stand up to recite that. Most hepatitis is subclinical. You never know you have it, okay? You don't get jaundiced. But when you do, because the definition of hepatitis is of inflammation of the liver, you generally have increase of cells within the portal triad, at least in the early or more mild stages. Now here, let me ask you this. I know I don't have to, but what's that big round thing there? Just give me a quick thing. Okay, I know you know it. What's this little epithelial tube over here? And what is this thing over here, this tinier one? That's a smaller duct. And what is this little thing filled with blood that has a thicker wall over here? And what is that thing over there? So you're seeing all the things you can see. Now here's the very most important question I want to ask you. Do you see this interface now between the portal tract and the edge of the hepatocytes? I want to ask you a question. Now think carefully, because I don't want any wrong answers. Is this limiting plate intact, or is it breached? Well, I'm getting both answers, and I'm glad, because the persons that said breached, I want to tell you, most of your GI pathologists, you know, like Jim Liu, he'll tell you that this is probably an intact limiting plate. Even though it looks a little bit irregular, you really don't see immigration of these inflammatory cells out into the sinusoids. However, in the more severe form of hepatitis, you have inflammation not only in the portal areas but in the sinusoids, and the chief inflammatory cells are lymphocytes and macrophages. Now listen, even though it may be called acute hepatitis, the inflammatory cells are classically chronic inflammatory cells. In other words, lymphocytes and macrophages. And by the way, do you see all these inflammatory cells here in the portal area? What are 90% of them? I'll give you three choices. Neutrophils, lymphocytes, or macrophages. Yeah, they're all lymph. They almost look like a little lymphoid nodule, don't they? Okay, good. What is this? This is something we call acute fulminant hepatitis. Now, in a relatively small percentage of cases of hepatitis B, it might be like 1%, the patients die during the acute phase of the illness because there is massive destruction to the liver. And that's called acute fulminant hepatitis. Now, if you think that this liver is a lot smaller than it should be, or hepatomegaly rather than hepatomegaly, you're absolutely right. Why is the liver smaller than it should be? Here, I told you that in hepatitis you get swelling and sometimes it's bigger, but we have a liver here that's smaller than it should be. Why is it small? Well, the reason why it's small is because the lobules have collapsed. Okay, do you see all these little glandular things out here? At first thing you might say, well, this looks like metastatic adenocarcinoma, but it's not. These are bile ducts. And the reason why these are primarily bile ducts in the liver is the hepatic parenchyma, the hepatocytes, have collapsed. The lobules have collapsed. And that's why the liver is smaller. And that's why, even though this is a big section of the liver, you cannot probably find one single normal-looking hepatocyte here. They've collapsed. That's what they call acute fulminant hepatitis. It has an extremely high mortality rate. Let's, for all practical purposes, let's say 100%. Okay? Here is another hepatitis, and you can see some inflammation. This is not a portal area now. You know these are sinusoids, but nevertheless, you see some sprinkling of lymphocytes in these sinusoids. But in addition, you see these red little cells that look like they lost their nucleus. What are they called? Those are called Councilman bodies. And I hate the word Councilman body, because why don't they just say apoptotic hepatocyte due to hepatitis, because that's what they are. Hepatitis B, here's the cold facts. About 2/3 of them are subclinical. You never even know you have it. Only about 1/4 of them can you actually see signs, you know, jaundice, fever, dark urine, light stools of acute hepatitis. A small percentage of those will be healthy carriers. In other words, they carry the virus their whole life possibly, but they never get sick. Now, a relatively small percentage, like about 4, they can have a persistent infection, but they can still go on to recovery. Now, about a third of the persistent infections don't recover, and they go on to cirrhosis. And guess what? 10% of those people with cirrhosis develop hepatocellular carcinomas. The reason why there's an arrow going to this little box that says hepatocellular carcinoma is that you can only develop it in a background of cirrhosis. And of course, cirrhosis means death. Hepatocellular carcinoma means death. But also remember that about 1% of patients with the acute hepatitis can also die in the acute phase. It's less than 1%, but that's big enough because look at, there's 185,000 cases of hepatitis B every year in the United States, and probably 20 times as much in the Eastern Hemisphere, okay? About 1% of those die acutely. Now, here's hepatitis C. It's not the same as B. There are features about it that make it a lot better. First of all, it's not nearly as common. It's about 1/4 as common, okay? And nobody dies from acute hepatitis C. If it was 1% with B, it's practically zero with C. But look it, it's much more likely to go into chronic hepatitis. 85% of the people that have hepatitis C develop chronic hepatitis C. If you remember, the ratio was reversed with B. Now, you want to know something else? If you have cirrhosis, or you're not stable, you develop cirrhosis, it's more likely linked with hepatoma than B. So I was walking around thinking that, gee, C is worse for hepatoma than B. That's because I'm a very narrow-minded person. And then I went to China last year, and I went to the International Conference on Hepatoma, and everybody was talking about hepatitis B rather than hepatitis C. Well, the reason why that is because there's just so much more hepatitis B than hepatitis C. So even though these are more likely to go into hepatoma, they're not nearly as common as hepatitis B. So if you have a person in China that has hepatitis C, I'm sorry, if you have a person in China that has liver cancer, most likely it's from hepatitis B. If you have a person in the United States that has liver cancer, most likely it followed. It's equally likely that it was either from B or C. Okay, here's some of the graphs of the lab tests. Now, of course, if the patient completely recovers, a lot of these things go down, like the anti-hepatitis B antibody and the anti-hepatitis H. Okay, if it goes into chronic disease, however, the enzymes can remain elevated. Okay, the jaundice may go away in chronic hepatitis, but the symptoms may persist. And they'll generally get not as severe as in the acute stage, but they still persist. So look at, see this big here, your serum transaminases? They go up pretty quick. But within a few weeks, they're back down again. Whereas if you have chronic disease, they come back up, but they don't go all the way down. They stay there because there's persistent hepatocyte damage. Now another thing I want you to remember, you know, I hate graphs like this, but I want you to remember, if you have a antigen that is on the surface of the virus and you make an antibody against that antigen, you're probably going to make that antibody sooner than if it was from an antigen on the inside of the virus, correct? Doesn't that make sense? So a lot of these persistent antibodies and how quick they appear is dependent on whether the antigen is on the surface of the virus or whether it's in the core. I don't want to go into this anymore, and I don't think it's important to look at all these crazy lines. I think we've just discussed the general principles. And once again, don't think that only hepatitis can be caused by viruses. Anything that inflames the liver can be called hepatitis. Staph can cause it. You can have a staph hepatitis and toxic shock. Okay, you could have gram-negative bacteria ascending up the bile ducts to cause a hepatitis. That would be called a cholangitis, but also involves the liver, so technically it's a hepatitis as well. You know that there's a variety of parasites. There's a stage in the development of malaria that's in the liver that'll cause a hepatitis. The schistosomes love to hang out in the liver. Liver flukes can cause it. And even though you can have amoebic abscesses in the liver, before you actually get to that abscess stage, you know that they're basically all around the liver. So they could cause a hepatitis too. Now, an abscess within the liver that's well localized technically is not a hepatitis, is it? But preceding that abscess, when you have diffuse inflammation, that's when you can have an amoebic hepatitis. Also, as you might guess, if your liver is inflamed because you are making antibodies against your own liver tissues, there's an autoimmune hepatitis, or in primary biliary cirrhosis, you're making antibodies against your own intrahepatic bile ducts. Now, having said all that, the single biggest cause of hepatitis, non-viral or viral, in the world is alcohol. Alcohol has a toxic effect on the liver. It can cause a hepatitis. We talked about this before, so don't forget it. In fact, you want to know something? I'm going to put that font a little bit lower, and I'm going to make the alcoholic font a lot bigger, because that's probably the number one cause of hepatitis. And of course, you won't have any viral things. The thing about alcoholic hepatitis that is generally differentiates it from the viral or other types of hepatitis is that when you have an alcoholic hepatitis, you usually have a lot of fat associated with it. Because remember, fatty livers are an alcoholic, so if you have alcoholic hepatitis, you probably have a lot of fat with it. In a lot of the viral hepatitises, you don't see fat. What about drugs? Well, once again, let's go back to our principle, is that we have to regard just about any drug as being potentially hepatotoxic. And remember, if your package insert, which you should know when you prescribe any drug, recommends doing baseline transaminases or membrane enzymes, you know that these drugs are more likely to cause either liver damage or cholestasis. The typical toxic effect on the liver is from alcohol, and you know that that causes fatty livers or steatosis. You also know that long term it may cause fibrosis and nodules, which we call cirrhosis as well. Probably the number one common over-the-counter NSAID, which causes terrible liver disease, is Tylenol. Acetaminophen is famous for occasionally causing central lobular necrosis, and of course the people that take it are just buying it over the counter and they're not doing baseline liver enzymes. But you have to remember, after alcohol, probably Tylenol is like the number one cause of terrible liver disease. People die from it every year. Some of the drugs cause a hepatitis type of a picture. Some of them can cause diffuse necrosis. I just put in the ones that are the common ones. Granulomatous changes you can see in certain toxic situations. And of course, cholestasis, you should remember, the steroids, the birth control pills, the androgens, the estrogens are famous for causing cholestasis in the liver. In that case, you want to do a baseline ALK-FAS rather than perhaps a baseline transaminase. Okay, I'm going to go over something also very quickly. No, as a matter of fact, I'm not. I think we're going to stop here. I got a few things left. I got about I got about 30 slides left. I knew I wouldn't be able to do the whole thing today. So what we'll do on the next session is we'll finish this off in the first hour, and then we'll do a liver histopathology lab in the second hour. So we'll call it a day, because I know you've been working hard and listening hard, and so have I. So I'm not going to stress you out anymore. I'm going to reward you by not going overtime. I think that the worst thing you could do to do for a student who's been working hard is punishing them by making them work harder. So let me look at my little question box here and pop out the question window. I'm already starting to see a lot of thank yous. When I see a lot of thank yous, what that really means is thank you for shutting up. I'm tired of listening to you. Somebody said, why do you get lymphocytes rather than neutrophils for acute hepatitis? Can I tell you, the person who asked this was Asma Zara. I don't know the answer. I don't know the answer. But it's a fact. Somebody said, is fatty liver reversible after removing the cause? The answer is yes, absolutely yes. Otherwise, I just see a bunch of thank yous, and I'm thankful for that. And remember, if you want to A for the course, email me a nice class picture, and you know my email address is the same as my name. It's menarsik@gmail.com. Okay, folks, let's close it off now. You know, I'm going to take a look to see if any hands are raised as well. Sometimes somebody raises their hands. Most people don't. There's still a lot of you out there. I don't see any raised hands. I'm kind of tired anyway. So let's call it a day. It's already at the 2-hour mark. And we will play a song that chokes me up a lot. So I'm glad you're not going to be listening to me while we're listening to it. This is one of my favorite movies of all time and the song from it. Buzzards.